Jason, first tell everyone what you do for a living.
I am self-employed as the architect of WOW. Really what that means is I'm a business consultant. However, I kind of provide overall marketing strategies, human growth development, accountability, but really getting in there and helping the business owners clarify their vision and putting that into action.
Okay, at State of the Spark, we have like a huge focus on missions or humanitarian work, what I call philanthropia, and you're familiar with this term. Mm-hmm. How close is your area of interest, how closely aligned is Architect of WOW with living a life of philanthropia as you understand it, as we've talked in the past? How close are they related?
You know, I think it's funny. I think a lot of people kind of tend to differentiate those worlds and mm-hmm. create them or think about them very independently.
Yeah.
And I think at the heart of that, it's finding out what people need and striving to meet the need. Mm-hmm. And so whether it's meeting, you know, someone's physical needs in Haiti, or if it's meeting with a guy who's doing $3 million a year in sales,
yeah,
but he has core values that aren't being lived out in his company, and he desperately wants those to happen so that he can not only stay in business, but so that he can serve his clients mm-hmm. and his employees better.
Yeah.
So ultimately, it's all about need and trying to fulfill that need.
Gotcha. So you pretty much, you view what you do as mission, so to speak, in serving other people and helping them get that.
It's service.
Yeah. Okay. Now, how does your consultant work, does your consultant work differ at the core of what you want to be doing at large for human service? Is there a difference? Do you see at all? Is it fully manifested yet? The type of consulting you're currently doing? I mean, on the ground reality, you do all kinds of consulting. You're consulting with a group, Loan Finders. You've consulted with different groups, gyms, music schools. Has that manifested fully in the way that you ultimately see your legacy of influence to be? Are they fused yet, those visions, with the reality?
I think it's an ever-evolving process.
Okay.
I really see those, again, getting, to use your word, fused more and more.
Mm.
It's been very cool. I think there's been a lot of simplicity happening lately where, again, it really boils down to, and it's going to sound redundant because I'm sure this is going to come up a lot,
yeah,
but it's all about serving. At the core of it, it's all about serving.
Yeah.
And I think that I'm learning how to bring my skill sets, my passion, my vision, my mission towards how can I use all of that to serve the business community.
Bam. That's what it is. Cool. Could you pick out maybe three top elements of when you sit to consult from this paradigm of serving others? What are the top three areas that you deal with, in your case, your business clients? What are the top two or three areas that you want to focus in when you go into that office and meet with those clients and you know you want to bring change to make people's lives better? What are the top three areas you focus on with that client?
Always start with clarity. I call that actually complete clarity. And really what that is figuring out not just the vision, the long-term kind of range of where they want to take their business, but really clarifying that down into their goals, their vision, their mission, their values. I spend a lot of time on values.
Yeah.
Because ultimately that becomes, in my mind, the foundation, the fundamental backbone for every action that we take. Mm. And unless you clarify those, there's going to be a lot of different people doing different things for different reasons.
Yeah.
And so really clarifying, this is who we are, this is what we stand for, and that creates expectation. So again, going back to clarity. Number two, I call it pivotal people.
Okay.
I believe that in many ways, business has sucked the humanity out of day-to-day operations. It's become very nitty-gritty. We're running lean. We're running mean. It's all about the bottom line. It's all about numbers. It's all about spreadsheets. And it's less about heart. It's less about emotion. It's less about feeling. It's less about caring.
Yeah.
And I think that those elements need to be reintroduced back into business with a fury. Because I believe, I was talking to somebody yesterday about Bank of America.
Yeah.
Bank of America has become one of the most hated and reviled companies there is.
Mm.
And yet there is no person that we associate with Bank of America. There's, you know, past and present CEOs, there's presidents, and there's the executive team. We don't necessarily focus our intense dislike and maybe even hate on them, per se. And it's certainly not the people in the at the branch that we hate. We just hate this thing called Bank of America because it's lifeless, and it's engaging in a lot of things that feel very removed from, I care about you as my client. And so, again, for me, it's all about people. And so, number one, you know, I sit with the business owner and I help them clarify what's important to you. What are you trying to accomplish? Because you're a person. You have needs as well.
Interesting.
From there, we clarify, what are the needs of your employees? What do they need to not only perform their job well, but what do they need to show up every morning and be excited to be there?
So it's about people again.
All about people.
Interesting.
And then the third group is the clients.
Yeah.
And so we find out what they want and need. So clarity, people, and then strategy and execution. It's all about, you know, we are actually trying to grow businesses.
Interesting.
And so we add on some of the marketing elements and some of the things. But I was telling one of my clients yesterday, I said, I honestly believe that the way that you can grow your business the best is for you to focus on core values and to demonstrate those in every interaction you have.
Bam. Interesting. I mean, that's dynamic, and there's a lot behind that. I've recently been talking more and more about something that I've believed for a long time, and that's the rehumanization of work. And people will, as much as we have relationships with brands, because what you're describing is the new brand of Bank of America is, I hate that, you know? And it's very easy to hate a lifeless zombie of a business. But when you rehumanize it, when you revitalize it to people, about people, it's hard to hate that, you know? And there's also purification that has to go along with actions being integrated with moral values and all those things. So interesting. I mean, that's an interesting observation. Now let me ask... Did you always have a lifelong vision for this type of work?
No. Yeah. I would say, honestly, the first 25 years of my life were kind of on autopilot. Really didn't have much vision at all. And it's been an ever-evolving, you know, I'm 34 years old right now.
Yeah.
And so I think that, you know, it wasn't like you just get your vision and you just carry it forward. At least it wasn't that way for me.
Yeah.
So it's been an ever-evolving thing.
Interesting. On a scale of 1 to 10, now that you've gone into this manifestation of your service to humanity, on a scale of 1 to 10, how fulfilling has this work been?
10.
Really?
Really has.
Okay.
Not every element, not every day, but there have been moments lately where it's like you walk away from working.
Yeah.
And you realize that you have more energy leaving work than when you walked in.
What started, can you pick a time that something started you on this path of going, wait, I have a hint, you might not have known clearly, but I have a hint that there is a higher or highest way to serve people. Can you point back to what started your passion for this work?
I mean, it started off, I think, as a kid. You know, my dad was a small business owner, and I saw him in a lot of ways struggle and try to make it, and he didn't have the resources, he didn't have cheerleaders, he didn't have people alongside of him that were like, Terry, what's your vision? How can we help you? How can we motivate you? How can we give you the tools, resources, tips, whatever it was that you don't have? And I think that was a start.
Interesting.
I mean, obviously there's been just a lot of things, but really going back to kind of the roots of the beginning of my story, I think that was a huge catalyst.
Interesting. Has there ever been a time that you were unsure of whether or not you'd be working? Like you grasped the vision, you started out. Has there been any moments since where you're like, oh, I don't know if I can do this, or I'm not sure if I should do this?
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Absolutely.
Can you describe any of those moments or dilemma or any of those mental discussions you had?
I don't know where I got this kind of analogy or story, but it really is stuck in my mind. I don't know if it's the Sahara Desert or what, but I know there's a very large desert. And what they had done in order to traverse that desert was they had placed black oil cans as strategic points that were, if you were standing at one, and you were just looking at the horizon, you could just see the next one. And it was just enough of a speck that you could start taking steps forward to that next oil can. Oh, and there was nothing else around you that you could see, except maybe the last oil can.
Yeah.
And there have been times where I've seemingly been in the middle of the desert, and I haven't seen that black, you know, oil barrel that was kind of my destination point, that was the next thing that I was moving towards.
Interesting, yeah.
But again, that has been a process. It really has been one day at a time, one step forward. What do I feel? And a lot of times it really has been uncovering my heart. What's in my heart? What drives me? What provides me an emotional spark, really, to use your word? Because there are certain things that I've done where it sounds good.
Yeah.
But when I do it, it either falls flat or it doesn't have the effect that I was maybe going for. And when I've learned to listen to my heart and go, what do I really think I was put here to do? When I've strived to do that, it's been completely different.
Interesting. What do you remember, any specific points that, despite maybe doubts or concerns, is there ever a turning point you could refer to? That was that turning point where I was confirmed that this is what I would be doing. Do you have anything like that you could think of? Or?
It was funny. When I started using the name The Architect of WOW, it was very interesting kind of how that name occurred.
Interesting.
But there were a lot of people that as soon as I started saying, and for me that was kind of a big jump, The Architect of WOW, I mean that kind of sounds a little bit silly, a little bit grandiose.
Yeah.
And for me to just go, no, that's who I am, that's what I want to produce. When I started saying that, immediately it resonated with people that knew me very well.
Oh, yeah.
And said, yeah,
That happened with me with State of the Spark. That's funny you say that, because I never would have said that until you just said that. But State of the Spark, when I could finally articulate it in that phrase, I almost didn't care if anyone would buy into that. Mm-hmm. I almost didn't care... if I had $1 million worth of billables and clients and all this fun stuff, really, I just knew that it was about that message. Mm-hmm. And whether I could even... That's good. That's good. That's awesome that you brought that up. Now, what role has vision, setting goals and the like, played in this growth phase you're in of doing this type of work? What role has vision and setting goals played to get you here?
You know, for me, Grant, I think it's been a little bit unique. I mean, you know, we've all read a lot of books. We've listened to a lot of Brian Tracy. We've listened to a lot of different goal-setting programs. And it's a very sequential, you know, this is your short-term goals and your mid-term goals and your long-term goals. And, you know, you put it all on paper and whammo. Not so much for me. I think really the key thing for me has been to clarify again the vision. And that is ever-evolving, sometimes a little bit more concrete than other times.
Yeah.
But really, it's looking at that big vision out there and going, what could I do today? What could I do tomorrow? What could I do this week that I think would help me get there?
And it sounds like linguistically you're separating vision from goal setting.
Very much.
Got it. That's cool.
Mm-hmm.
That's cool. I agree with that.